Hazard Program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars, attention all cars, broadcast 116. Be on the lookout for two Negroes. Number one described as about 6 feet, weight 180 pounds, age 27. Number two, thin, 5 feet 8 inches, weight 120. These men just held up and killed a streetcar conductor. That's all. Rolls in the place. Perhaps some of our listeners think we are too enthusiastic when we say that Rio Grande cracked gasoline has superiority over all other brands. You've heard us make strong claims for our exclusive patented cracking process, and perhaps you've discounted these claims as mere advertising talk. We haven't given you technical reasons in these radio talks for Rio Grande's superiority, but now we have prepared a simple, easy-to-understand explanation of Rio Grande's extraordinary cracking process. This explanation is interestingly illustrated and is convincing proof that Rio Grande really does give you greater value for your money when you buy cracked gasoline. For the first time, the true secret of Rio Grande's cracked, greater power and speed is revealed. And you can read all about it in the latest issue of the Calling All Cars News. It's a special double-sized edition this month, full of true detective stories, latest movie and radio news, and it illustrates a lot of new free gifts for boys and girls. Get your free copy of this fascinating publication today, wherever Rio Grande cracked gasoline is sold. You'll learn the real reason why this extra value gasoline powers more police and emergency cars than any other brand. Once again, it is our pleasure to present Chief James E. Davis of the Los Angeles Police Department.
Good evening, friends. We have heard much criticism concerning our ridiculous parole system. It cannot be denied that many major crimes have been committed by beneficiaries of this system who fail to show a sense of decency and gratitude which obligates these transgressors to recognize society's effort to reform rather than punish. A parole system is one thing. The slipshod manner in which it is administered is another. As the head of the largest law enforcement agency in the state of California, I recognize the fact that rehabilitation is as much a part of our criminal problem as punishment. But I cannot condone a system which falls so far short of its high idealism as does our California parole system. Executive leniency and official indifference, more often neglect, let loose upon our law-abiding citizens, degenerates, and criminals far better off behind the bars. Tonight's story reveals a typical and appalling aftermath of parole. We have selected it at random. The police records of this state and every state of this union are filled with just such stories as the one to which you are about to listen. Between the years 1921 and 1932, the June bug was arrested 22 times. The parole board let him loose, although he was a known burglar and potential killer. When he learned that a weak and apologetic parole system would always let him out, his killer instincts came to the surface, and in his viciousness, vowed that no jail could hold him. But how appallingly true was that criminal's conclusion. He knew that under our indeterminate sentence law, that men selected not merely because of any particular fitness for handling crime and criminals, but mainly to award political services, would sit in final judgment. He knew that after all the court's delays, if he could outsmart the coppers, he would have 99 chances out of 100 to beat a rap in the big house. The story of the June bug is its own indictment of the California parole system.
Jefferson City, Missouri, August 12, 1924.
For the crime of robbery in the first degree, I sentence you, Willie Jones, alias Julius Jones, to the term of 5 years in the state penitentiary.
Los Angeles, July 21st, 1928.
And so, Willie Jones, alias Julius Green, it is the decision of this court that you serve the maximum sentence as prescribed by law for the crime of robbery in the second degree. Not less than one, no more than 15 years in the Fulton Penitentiary.
March 24th, 1932.
Willie Jones, alias Willie Green, you are aware of the terms of this parole. It's now entirely up to you whether you stay on the outside or come back to Folsom.
I'll never be back in Folsom, boss.
6 months later in downtown Los Angeles.
Yes, you come now. Now, wait till you stop, then follow me.
Will I?
Now, Cole, there's a break. Look at that. That car's got to stop for that signal. Come on.
Carefully.
Yes, there's a stick up. No, no, no. Don't put your hands up. Just aim me over that chair.
Hey, take it easy with that gun, buddy. I'm not making sense.
Come on. Shut up with your arm rolling in it. Come on here, Mr. Conductor. Make a snap now.
Listen, if I give you this money, I'll lose my job.
Put out here, Bogart.
Listen.
Maybe it's just a teacher not to talk back.
You got it.
Just a moment. Let's get over here. Come on. Come on.
Sanders, robbery detail. Captain McCaleb speaking.
This is Jewett, Captain. There's been a shooting out here at Alameda in 41st. A couple of Negroes attempted to hold up a street car and shot the conductor.
You got the Negroes?
No, sir. They got away in the dark before I arrived.
All right, Jewett. See if you can get any witnesses. I'll send a couple of the boys out there right away.
Captain McCaleb assigns to the case detectives George Gibson and R.M. Jack, who proceed to the scene of the shooting, interrogate the only witness to the crime, and then return to headquarters.
Well, boys, what did you find? Well, not too much, I'm afraid. The fellow who saw the shooting was on the streetcar at the time, and all he was able to tell us was that the bandit was a Negro. Apparently, he got scared or something and shot the conductor before he knew what he was doing.
Get any description other than the color of him?
Yeah, he wore a gray cap and was fairly young. That's about all.
Well, I tell you what you'd better do. You and Jack go down in the Central Avenue District and browse around. See what you can pick up. If this is a local boy, you might be able to get some dope on his identity. Wait a minute. Let me see what this is. Robbery detail, McCaleb speaking.
Hello, Captain. This is Jewett again. That conductor who was shot just died over at the receiving hospital.
What?
Yeah, never recovered consciousness. I thought you'd want to know.
Yeah, I do. Thanks, Jewett. Well, boys, our robbery case has turned into murder.
Description of the murderer of the streetcar conductor is immediately sent over the statewide teletype with the request to arrest and hold for murder. Meanwhile, Detectives Gibson and Jack mingle with the crowd in Los Angeles, Harlem District. Keep their ears open for any hint which might lead to the identity of the killer. It is a little past 1 o'clock in the morning, 3 days after the shooting in one of the small, smoke-filled nightclubs on Central Avenue.
I used to think I'd like this nightlife, Jack, but after 3 days of this, I'm beginning to think I was wrong.
You and me both.
Wouldn't be so bad if we could breathe.
Yeah, I'm getting till I've forgotten what fresh air smells like.
I thought he was calling me for a minute.
So did I. Thought maybe we'd found friends.
This is a night we're going to celebrate. Yes, now come on, dear. Sit yourself down here. Make yourself comfortable.
Look, I'm going to come in here, boy. Where do you want to get that money?
the money, and I ain't going to spend it.
Keep your ears open, George. Probably nothing to it, but this boy seems to be in a talkative mood. Can't tell what we might hear.
We'll probably hear plenty, but not along the lines we want. Well, it's a bit of entertainment anyway, and that's something.
That's plenty. I could stand a laugh or two at this point.
Well, look here, please. Look here. How would you like to have a diamond ring as big as the end of your thumb the way of your little brother?
Well, you won't go to get a diamond back here.
Never mind about that. That makes no difference. Yeah, what about you all tell me where I'm going to get these things? I'm asking you, does you want them?
No, I don't. But I don't think you can get them for me.
Well, you don't know. Well, let me tell you something, gal, and if you don't know right now, I'm going to have more cash than you can take a stick at pretty soon. Then what are you going to think?
You ain't forgetting that dream about something, because it's sure am mad at you.
You don't mean that Willie Jones, are you?
Uh-huh.
Well, I don't think he's going to bother me no more. Yeah, he got himself into a lot of trouble.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he ain't going to stick his head out of his house for a long time. Not till the police stop running around. But by that time, I'm going to be all okay.
Did you catch that, Jack?
Yeah, come on, let's get out of here. I have a hunch our man's name is Willie Jones, better known as the June Bug.
Acting upon this lucky clue, the two detectives check at headquarters and find that there is a Willie Jones with a past record living in Los Angeles. Months go by. Months. In which the police unceasingly search for Willie Jones, but the June Bug seems to have disappeared from the face of the earth. It is November of the same year. In a courtroom in El Centro, a group of prisoners are standing before the local judge to have the date set for their trial.
Trial set for December 15th. Prisoner will remain in the county jail until that time. Next case.
Jack Boswell, suspension of grand theft.
Is Jack Boswell here?
Yeah, I will. I'm Jack Boswell.
How do you plead at this time?
I never done nothing.
Trial set for December 21st. Next case.
You mean I'm going to stay here and stay out until then?
You'll remain in the county jail until then.
I ain't done nothing, Judge. What fool you gone keep me in this jail? That's what I want to know.
Come back to your cell, Sergeant. Next case, here's your telly.
Suspicion of robbery.
Is your telly here?
There you be, son. You might as well switch forth in because this is where you're going to be for quite a few weeks.
That's what you think. I'm not going to set you off for something I didn't do, no sir.
Well, it's all right by me. Only I wouldn't try eating those bars. They're pretty tough steel even for a hard guy like you.
Doggone fool, a labor of me. I saw them.
So funny, I thought I'd have to tell you about it. You should have seen his face. Boy, he was so mad he looked like he was going to bust.
Well, I don't think I'd go to him if I was you, Ben. He looks like a pretty mean customer. I'd hate to meet him in the dark if he ever gets out of here.
He ain't going to get out of here. Unless he eats his way out.
Busted out of his cell.
Yes, sir.
I don't see how he ever done it.
How long ago was this?
It couldn't have been very long ago, not more than an hour or so, because I was about by there about an hour and a half ago, and he was there then. I don't see how he ever done it.
Well, I bet it doesn't make a difference right now. You got to bring him back. They need a sheriff's office right away.
I was talking to the sergeant this morning, Chief, and he was saying...
Wait a minute. Hello, Sheriff. This is the chief, Sergeant. Just lost a prisoner. Busted out of his cell somewhere. Here's a description of him. Negro, 27 years old, 150 pounds, close cropped black hair.
Immediately, all available sheriff's cars and local police cars are sent out to scour the city for the missing Jack Boswell. And 2 hours later, the Imperial County Immigration Officers run across him hiding in a field, just outside the city limits. Once more, lodged in jail, he is placed on the constant guard, never out of sight of his jailer. And a few days later, from police bulletins, it is discovered that Jack Boswell and the long-missing Willie Jones are one and the same man. Los Angeles police officers bring the suspect back from El Centro to face trial for the murder of Elroy Armstrong, streetcar conductor. And one afternoon, 2 months after he returned to Los Angeles, Willie Jones, alias Jack Boswell, alias Julius Jones, is returned to his old habitat
Folsom Penitentiary. There he boasts continually that he won't be in jail long. That once he gets back to Los Angeles, his friends will take care of everything. But the days go by and the June bug remains in his cell. Early one moment, boastful the next. And one day in late November, he is called to the warden's office.
Jones, my men tell me you're a pretty tough customer, is that right?
I don't know what you're talking about, Warden. I ain't never done nothing.
I don't know if I'd exactly say that after looking at your past record, Jones.
I didn't do all them things they accused me of.
And that's something we'll know more about later. There'll be a sheriff from Los Angeles up here next week. He's coming up to take you back there for trial.
Is that right, Warden?
That's right, Jones. I thought maybe you'd rather talk to me before you left. Might be able to help you a little.
I ain't got nothing to talk about. Captain, I want to get right out of here just as soon as I can. What I do when I do get out of here, I'm staying out.
And there's nothing you'd like to say to me before you leave?
No.
All right, Jones. Be notified when it's time to go. You can go back to the cell now.
Yeah. And this time I won't be back. Goodbye, Warden. Oh, boy. And you ain't going to keep me right here in this jailhouse if I know it. No, sir. I ain't got no craving to spend the rest of my days in no 2x4 jail cell. A lot of stoolies, that's what I say. You know, sir.
What's this soliloquy about, Jonesy? You got things on your mind?
That's none of your business, white boy. I don't have to tell you my plans, do I? Well,
so you've got a case of button left, huh, Chubby? You better stop mumbling to yourself or they'll put you away in a nice padded cell where you can count your fingers all day.
Just you know, white boy. I don't have to listen to your talk all the time. You ain't careful, I'm going to smack you one.
Same bullet. Jonesy here's got to be a regular tough guy. Think he's going to wipe up the whole lot of us if we don't show more respect. Maybe he thinks he's killing
you. I see your muscles every week, and I bet you're a swell set up boxer.
Go ahead and laugh. There's your head over your over the neck, you men. I'm getting on here next week. Get off, Jeff. You'll find out plenty. I'm getting over here. No, I ain't coming back.
One week later, November 30th, 1932, Willie Jones does get out, but on his right wrist, he wears one half of a pair of shiny handcuffs, the other half of which adorn the stalwart wrist of Deputy Sheriff H.M. Dennison, Transportation Deputy of the Los Angeles Sheriff's Office. The officer and his manacled companion board the Southern Pacific train at the Regressive Station and settle down in their berth for the overnight trip ahead of them.
Well, Jones, guess it's time for bed. Mind sleeping in the office? Wouldn't make much difference if it did, would it?
Yeah, you're a pretty sour guy, aren't you? Well, that's all right with me. Mm-hmm. I can be sour, too, when I want to. I've got a little present for you when you get settled up there. Nice pair of leg irons.
You ain't all going to put them on me, is you?
I certainly am. And maybe I can get a good night's sleep without worrying about where you are.
How can I sleep with them? Everything's on me.
That's your problem, Jones. I was told not to take any chances with you. This is one of the best ways of doing that I know of.
Fine way to treat a fellow what ain't done nothing.
All right, that'll do. Now, stick out your leg. That's right. I don't imagine you'll be apt to do much traveling on your own with those on, especially with them locked around that steel support. Well, good night, Jones. Sleep tight.
Weary from his strenuous day's work, Deputy Dennison soon falls into a heavy sleep, safe in the knowledge that his prisoner is securely fastened to the steel girder in the upper berth. And Jones, the June bug, lies above, thoughts running rampant through his distorted mind.
I wouldn't take no spars. They're pretty tough steel, even for a hard guy like you.
But old dead steel.
Maybe you think he's killing you, huh? That's a swell cheddar box, huh?
But old dead.
Do much traveling on your own, especially with those leg irons on.
Now, I'm going to get over here. Now, maybe I'll get this here lock with this coat. I've got to get off this train. Doggone, it seems to make too much noise.
crouching on the step of the speeding Pullman car, fighting the wind that threatens to hurl him to the roadbed below, the June bug waits for a chance to jump. As the November night fades into the first hour of the new day, the train slows to a panting stop for water in the little town of Woodford. Ducking in between two freight cars lying on the siding, Jones opens the stolen valise, secures the deputy's gun, then watches with grim satisfaction as the train pulls slowly out of the station, bearing his sleeping guardian with it. Passenger train pulls into another outlying station. Deputy Dennison awakes and discovers that he has lost his charge. Dashing into the small station house, he phones his superior in Los Angeles and asks for assistance, offering $100 reward to the person who returns Jones to his custody. Constable Truman W. Hamilton of Woodford Township is notified to be on the lookout for the fugitive Negro as our police up and down the main line between Los Angeles and Reseda. Driving his red Ford coupe, Constable Hamilton drives to the Woodford station, parks, and starts an investigation of his own. But as he rounds a large tank car, he suddenly finds himself staring into the business end of a pearl-handled automatic, firmly gripped by a huge Negro.
Put him up. What? Yeah, go on. Put him up, I say. Don't waste no time doing it either.
All right, yeah, that's better.
Oh, don't mind if I take your gun, do you? I might need you.
What are you going to do?
You and me is going for a little ride in your car. And you is going to do the driving.
There's a posse out looking for you. If they see us, they'll kill both of us before they know who I am.
Show tough luck for you, boy. Because they ain't going to kill me. Come on now, get in that car.
Yeah.
Not. Now, just get me around on the other side and we'll be on our way. Come on now, get that thing moving.
Listen, if I let you take the car, won't you leave me here? I've got my life to think of.
Given you all don't shut up your mouth, you'll have no life to think about. Come on now. Get this here. He's moving.
All right. Where do you want to go to?
Drive out to the main highway and head south toward Los Angeles.
Okay. I suppose you know that you can't get away with it.
You drive that car. I'll take care of the rest.
This highway will be filled with police cars in a few minutes.
And when they see you, they won't dare shoot. You was my protector.
I wish I could believe that.
Meanwhile, Deputy Sheriff Jeb Stewart of the Newhall substation and his partner, Deputy Sheriff Carter, notified of the escape, are cruising the highway between Newhall and Salton, eagerly scanning every passing car, hoping they will stop the red Ford coupe. Jeb hearing the words because of Constable Hamilton. When suddenly...
Looks like some sort of light flashing over the other side of that ride.
Yeah. Be able to see what it is when it's up the hill.
Yes. Look. It's an old Ford, all right.
Turn off the light. Quick.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, if this is it, let him pass. Then we can turn around and get him from behind.
Yeah.
Have a better chance that way of missing Hamilton.
That's it. Hamilton's driver. That's what's missing the funny part.
You said it.
All right.
I'll turn around and follow him.
Maybe we could shoot the tires away. That'd stop them.
Yeah? What do you suppose that guy would do to Hamilton if we did that?
Yeah, you're right.
Watch it. I think they're slowing down.
What's up?
I don't know.
Hold it.
That's funny. The Ford stopped.
Look. One of them is looking out that back window. Can't see whether it's Hamilton or the other one. He's going to shoot it out with us.
Keep down low. I'm going to take a chance to through that back glass. We could only have a few cartridges left. Maybe we can get him to waste them.
If he doesn't hit one of us first. Look, the door's open.
It's Hamilton. Now we can blast the back out of that Ford.
You hit him, look.
Come on. We're going to close in on him.
Look.
Hamilton's been hit, too. Lying over there on the road.
Yeah, come on. Hamilton, are you badly hit?
In my back. I can't tell how badly. Did you get that guy?
Yeah. You won't have to worry about him anymore. He caught a 45 slug smack through the head. Come on, Carter.
Give me a boost with Hamilton into our car. We've got to get him to the hospital.
Now, what about that Negro?
You stay here with him. I'll send the boys back to the wagon to pick up the body.
Rushing the wounded Constable Hamilton back to the New Hall Receiving Hospital, Stewart notifies the substation and asks them to go at once to the deserted spot in Mint Canyon to pick up Deputy Carter and the body of Jones, the June bug. This done, he returns to the operating room, hearing the worst.
How is he, Doc?
We'll know in a minute. Just got him on the table.
All ready, Doctor.
Oh, thanks.
Well, let's see.
How's about it, Doc? Is it bad?
Hamilton, you're not just about the luckiest constable I know.
Huh? Oh, what do you mean, Doc?
Simply this. You see this leaden pellet I have in my hand?
Bullet.
Yeah. The one that has your name on it. Only this particular slug stopped on its way and hit something else first.
You mean it's not a bad wound?
I mean that it's not even big enough to be called a wound. I picked this bullet out of your back with my fingers. Left a dent in his back about an eighth of an inch deep. He'd be fit as a fiddle just as soon as he recovers from the shock of being hit.
Doc, I've never had an awful lot of love for you bone snatchers, but right now, if you could cook, I'd marry you.
So ends the story of the Junebug, the principal character, a paroled yet hardened criminal. Lay dead in the morgue with a .45 caliber police bullet in his brain. But what of the police officer whose life he vowed to take before he would go back to the big house? What of the parole system which made it possible for this potential killer, gun in hand, his brain distorted, and in its madness conspiring to get even with society? Only an informed and outraged public can answer that question and revise the laws which fall so far short of their altruistic objectives.
Thank you, Chief David. The Los Angeles Police Department realizes that swift seconds count when criminals must be kept. Hundreds of radio cars patrol the city day and night, ready to dash to the scene of a crime. As these cars cruise slowly about, hour after hour, they require an economical gasoline. Then, when the alarm sounds, they require an emergency gasoline as they leap to top speed and go roaring to the rescue. Rio Grande cracked gasoline has met these requirements more efficiently than any other gasoline. And that's why it's specified exclusively for the police and emergency cars of Los Angeles, Oakland, Berkeley, Maricopa County, Arizona, and many other cities and counties. You'll find the secret of Rio Grande's success revealed for the first time in the new double-sized edition of the Calling All Cars News. Get your free copy of this interesting publication wherever Rio Grande cracked gasoline is sold. If you have boys or girls in your family, ask the Rio Grande attendant about the many new free gifts, the G-Man and G-Detective outfits. But the biggest bargain of all at Rio Grande stations is Sinclair Motor Oil. The motor oil and all the harmful petroleum jelly removed. A whole quart of concentrated, pure, guaranteed lubrication for only 25 cents and 30 cents in sealed cans.
The friendly police calling all cars, attention all cars. Cancellation broadcast 116. Perspectivist case shot down in Mint Canyon. That's all. Rose and Quick.
This is your narrator, Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night for the Rio Grande Oil Company. But the biggest bargain of all. Calling All Cars, the copyrighted program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company.
San Rafael police calling all cars, attention all cars. Be on the lookout for a gang of housebreakers known to be operating in San Rafael. Further details to follow.
San Francisco Bay Area of Northern California, an area where the police are enthusiastic users of Rio Grande crack gasoline. All the police and emergency cars of Oakland and the neighboring city of Berkeley use nothing but Rio Grande crack gasoline. In Southern California, the largest law enforcement body in the West, the Los Angeles Police Department, use nothing but Rio Grande crack gasoline. In Arizona, the largest county in the state is Maricopa, and every car operated by the county sheriff's office uses Rio Grande crack gasoline. In fact, wherever calling all cars is heard, more police and emergency cars use Rio Grande crack than any other brand. And all these thousands of emergency cars use exactly the same gasoline you get from your neighborhood Rio Grande dealer. At the same price you pay for ordinary gasoline, you can enjoy the extra flavor.